27. Number 27. Be with me, Lord, I cannot live without thee. I dare not try to take one step alone. I cannot bear the loads of life unaided. I need thy strength to lead myself upon. Be with me, Lord, and then if danger threaten, if storms of trials burst above my head, if flashing seas leap everywhere about me, they cannot harm or make my heart afraid. Be with me, Lord, no other gift or blessing thou couldst bestow could with this one compare. A constant sense of thy abiding presence where'er I am, to feel that thou art near. Be with me, Lord, when loneliness o'ertakes me, when I'm asleep amid the fires of pain, and when shall come the hour of my departure, for worlds unknown, oh Lord, be with me then.
382.
There's a holy and beautiful city whose builder and ruler is God. John saw it descending from heaven when Patmos in exile he trod. Its high massive wall is of jasper, the city itself is pure gold. And when my throat in here is folded, mine eyes shall its glory behold. In that bright city, pearly white city, I have a mansion, a robe and a crown. Now I am watching, waiting and longing for the white city John saw coming down. No sin is allowed in that city, and nothing defiling nor mean. No pain and no sickness can enter, no crape on the doorknob is seen. Her sorrows and cares are forgotten, no tempter is there to annoy. No parting words ever are spoken, there's nothing to hurt and destroy. In that bright city, pearly white city, a robe and a crown. Now I am watching, waiting and longing for the white city John saw coming down. No heartaches are known in that city, no tears ever moisten the eye. There's no disappointment in heaven, no envy and strife in the sky. The saints are all sanctified, holy, they live in sweet harmony there. My heart is now set on that city,
have a prayer? Brother Riley, if you would lead us in prayer.
Heavenly Father, we're thankful indeed for all the blessings we have. We're thankful, Father, for the night's rest and new day we have to come to worship thee, Father. We pray thy blessings upon us this day as we're gathered here. We pray for the speaker of the hour this morning, for both of them, Father, as they'll bring us thy word. We pray that we'll open our minds and hearts to that and apply those things to our lives. We're thankful again for this opportunity we have to come here this weekend for this lectureship. We thank you for the congregation, for its leadership. Continue to bless us, Father. We're mindful of those on beds of affliction. We pray thy blessings upon them and upon those who minister to them. Pray thee, Father, to restore them to the health and be according to thy will. We ask thee, Father, to continue with us through this day and through the remainder of our life. Father, we in the walks of this life, we pray that we hear those words well done by good and faithful servants. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
It's awfully hard to believe that the 37th annual West Kentucky Bible Lecture is coming to a close swiftly. And it has really been good. I hope everyone has benefited from it. I know that you have. The classes will stay up here in the auditorium this morning. I should have made these announcements prior to the song service, but I'm falling behind. It's good to have Brother Larry Acuff with us this morning at this hour to bring us a lesson on word is true from the beginning. I know we'll all benefit from this lesson and hope everybody can stay with us through the day. Brother Larry.
Thank you, Brother Darrell. What a joy it is to get to be with you this morning. I love those songs, but we just sing for about 2 hours, and then we'll preach four or five and sing another two or three. I love singing. The Bible teaches us, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. And I appreciate the invitation that you have extended to me to be with you this weekend for this lectureship. It's certainly always a joy. I've known of the Sunny Slope congregation for a long time as a result of Brother Riley. We love Brother Riley and Sister Susie and their work with the Richmond Hill congregation in Georgia. We're glad they're in Georgia. But I've known of this congregation, the singing here. You know, when I think about singing, I was holding a meeting in a little congregation called College, I believe it was College Grove. I don't remember the exact title, but anyway, this was many years ago. I had not been preaching very long, and they asked me to hold a meeting, and the meeting had started on Sunday, and I think went through a Friday night. And so on Friday night, I was there, and you know, Brother Glenn, I'm ready to preach, man. I'm since it's the last night of the meeting, and I'm ready to go. And so, you know, I thought, well, we'll have two songs, a prayer, a song, and that's the way Jude 3:4 tells us. And so, anyway, I thought we'll have two songs, a prayer and a song, and I'll get to preach. So after the prayer and the next song, I was ready to go. Well, the next thing I knew, another brother got up, he led a song. So when he got through singing, he sat down, another brother got up, he led a song. That went on for 45 minutes. And so I got up then and preached. At the conclusion of that lesson that night, there were six individuals who were baptized into Christ. I believe it was the singing that set their heart right for the preaching of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know what singing does? It just gets us ready. And I want to commend you for the beautiful. I could sit here and sing for, boy, that singing is beautiful. Thank you so much. It's my prayer as we study the Bible that you will grasp the message that we have planned for this morning. You know, saying, and I know this is true, Brother Robert, Brother Riley, Brother Keith, preachers, all of us, Brother Glenn, we want to make sure that the folks get the message. I'm sure Brother John, I know you preached for many years, and we want to make sure people get the message that we present. And I thought about this foreign exchange student who had come to America, and he was living with this family, but he was going to school, and he was just enamored with his teacher. She was just so, I mean, she was so good, and he just had appreciated her, and he loved her, and he wanted to do something for her, so he bought her a rose and a card. And he wrote in the card, now what he is doing, he's writing in English, but he's thinking in his foreign country, or he's thinking in English and writing in whatever. He wrote this card, got this rose, and on the card he wrote, "Dear teacher, this rose will live and die, but you, dear teacher, will smell forever." Well, you know, we want to make sure that we get it right, that we make sure that the message is received in the way that it is presented. In the book of Psalm 119, verse 160, you and I will find the statement that thy word is true from the beginning, and that every righteous judgment endureth forever. When you and I look at that passage of Scripture, and certainly we could survey the entire chapter of 119 of the book of Psalms, when you and I look at the Word of God, and David said, "Thy Word is true from the beginning," and really what we're looking at is this concept, and that is the fact that God's Word sums it up completely, that His Word, it is the summation. That when you and I look at the Scripture, all Scripture given by inspiration of God is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God might be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto every good work. That when you and I recognize from the book of Revelation chapter number 22 and verses 18 and 19 that the Bible pronounces upon those who would add to or take away from the words of the prophecy of this book. Or we look at the book of Proverbs or the book of Deuteronomy, and we see again the emphasis upon the Word of God and upon it being complete and it being true. The Bible says when we look into the perfect law of liberty and continue therein, when you and I recognize that the Word is true from the beginning, not just in the fact that at the very start of time, in Genesis chapter number 1, we see that word again, beginning. Genesis chapter number 1, verse 1, the Bible says, "In the beginning God created the heaven and the earth." When you and I go to the book of Mark, chapter number 1 and verse number 1, we find the Bible speaks of in the beginning, or the beginning of the gospel. When you and I read in John chapter number 1, again, the Bible says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." You and I go to the book of Matthew chapter number 19, and you remember that in this discussion on marriage, divorce, and remarriage, that when they asked the question, you know, is it lawful for a man to put away his wife? You remember what our Lord said, that he goes back to the very beginning. In the beginning, here is what is to be done. So when you and I look at that word beginning, and we understand that at the sound of God's voice in Genesis chapter 1, you and I incorporate the message that God has given to us. Now, when we also recognize, not in the beginning is thy word true, but you and I recognize in John 5, the Bible says, "Search the Scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and these are they which testify of me." That you and I must search the Scriptures. The Bible teaches us, John 17:17, you again know that our Lord searched the Scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and these are they which testify of me. You go to the book of Acts, chapter number 20, when Paul had called the elders of Ephesus together at Miletus, and he said this to them, "I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up." When you and I know that the Bible says that we look into that perfect law of liberty, or we go to John chapter number 15, and the Bible says, "I'm the true vine, my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. Every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, neither can you, except you abide in me." And he said, "If my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it'll be done to you." You and I see again that the Bible, the entire Word of God, all 66 books that you and I understand are inspired and from the God of heaven. That His Word is true from the beginning. In the book of Revelation, for an example, chapter number 20, The Bible says, John said, I saw a great white throne and him that sat upon it, from whose face the earth and the heavens fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. Now listen to this. The Bible says, and the books were open. And another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged of the things that were written in the books according to their works. The Bible said the sea gave up the dead that was in it. Death and hell delivered up the dead that were in them, and they were judged, every man according to his works. What was it based upon? It is based upon the word of God that's true from the beginning. When you and I again look at John 12 and verse number 48, Jesus said, he that rejecteth me and receiveth not my word hath one that judgeth him. The words that I speak unto you, they shall judge you in the last day. In Acts chapter number 17, a verse I'm sure all of you are familiar with, the Bible says, in the time of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent, for he hath appointed a day in which he will judge the righteous by that man whom he hath ordained and given assurance unto all men in that he hath raised him from the dead. My friend, every man, woman, boy, and girl who has reached the age of accountability will stand before God in the day of judgment. And the Bible says, and the books will be opened. This book will be, somebody said, that's going to take a long time. Well, where are you going? There's nowhere to go. The time has come. The end has come. Time shall be no more. And the Bible says that every one of us shall give an account of himself unto God. So when you and I go to Psalm 119, and we see that David also said, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Thy word is a lamp to my feet and a light unto my pathway. How shall a young man cleanse his way? Doing so by looking at the word of God. My friend, listen, I want to challenge us. That's why Paul said to Timothy in 2 Timothy 2 and verse 15, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. That you and I know, Paul writes to this young preacher Timothy, and he said that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures. If you and I can recognize today the essentiality, the need of taking the word of God and planting that word of God into our life, and let it be a light, let it be a guide, let it direct us in our life on a daily basis. We live in a strange world, ladies and gentlemen. We live in a world that is determined that you and I follow after the footsteps of the world and not after that of the word of God. Now, there are three sections of this lesson that I want to challenge you with today. Number one is this, and that is that you and I must love the word that comes to us from the beginning, and that we must preach that word. Now notice what the Bible said. Oh, David said, oh, how I love thy law. In the book of 2 Timothy, probably several times during this lectureship, the Bible says, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing in his kingdom. What does he say? Preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, and exhort with all long suffering and doctrine, for the time will come when men will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. They shall turn their ears from the truth and shall be turned to fables. The Apostle Paul said to this young preacher, I give you a charge. Now what is that? I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ that you do something, and that is that you preach the word. Now I want you to watch something here. The Bible says, he said, the time will come when men will not endure sound doctrine. He said, I want you to be instant, in season, out of season. I read Brother Marshall Keeble used to say that means to preach it when they like it and when they don't like it. And so when you look at that word season, when you and I look, there are three words I'm going to use here. Number one, that's the word season. Notice the Bible says you be instant in season, out of season. Now seasons change, all right? Now unless you live probably down in South Florida, or maybe in San Diego, California. Now in Michigan, we lived in Michigan for many years. My wife was reared there. And of course, there are only two seasons there, and that's winter and August. And so, the seasons, it's all, I remember one Sunday after we'd moved there, and we'd moved in January, and man, the day we moved, you talk about snow, it was snowing, I was really excited. I used to get in an old car and drive around, because see, in Tennessee, where I lived in Chattanooga, it didn't snow very often. I was excited when it would snow, and so I'd get in my old car and get the kids. We'd just drive around in the snow. Now, you can drive around Michigan, the snow, I mean, it's just getting around. You don't have to worry. They've plowed the streets and everything's good. So at any rate, I'd moved in January and snow. Well, now it's October. Man, we'd gone through the summer, and it is a beautiful day like that. Just crisp. The air is crisp. The sky is blue. And I was in the foyer, and a brother comes in, and he said, I said, man, isn't it a beautiful day? He said, yeah, but wait till February. Well, you know, there are the seasons. I mean, you and I understand the seasons. Folks go to Gatlinburg, Tennessee, the Great Smoky Mountain National Park, because of the season. They see the changing and the colors. Notice what the Bible says, that we are to be instant. In other words, we are to preach the Word of God in regardless of what the season may be. Now, I've got three seasons that I want to just pass along. Number one, and you could think of probably 15 others, number one is the season I call the season of pessimism. That there is a season when men are pessimistic. When you and I look at our society today, we look at our world, we look at what is happening. And there are some folks who get up in the morning and they'll say, good Lord, it's morning. Others get up and say, good morning, Lord. Because you look at a pessimistic concept. Now, I recognize, don't keep your head in the sand. I recognize that we face many problems in this life. We face many problems in our society today. But my friend, listen to this. The Bible is true. God is true. God is righteous. And you and I must stand with God at all times, because He will see us through the storms of life. In the book of Mark, you remember, They're out on the sea, and a great storm arose. And you and I know how that on that occasion the apostles asked our Lord, carest thou not that we perish? We sing that song, carest thou not that we perish? How canst thou lie asleep? Our Lord Jesus Christ arose. Peace, be still. Paul said, I can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth me. Paul said, my God shall supply all of my needs. You and I think of Elijah, and this was mentioned yesterday by Brother B.J. Clark, that you and I recognize, here this man Elijah, can you imagine? He has defeated the 450 priests of Baal. I mean, you look at what he had done. If the Lord be God, then serve him. And you know what happened in 1 Kings 18. And then in the very next chapter, Jezebel said, I'm going to get you, man. By tomorrow, you'll be dead like they are. Scared the life out of him. But God let him know very clearly, their 7,000 have not bowed their knee to Baal. You and I live in a pessimistic society, and we can't keep our head in the sand. I know that. But in Matthew chapter number 28, in that great commission, our Lord said, lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. The Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews chapter number 13, that I will never leave you nor forsake you. And you've heard this statement many, many times. I do not know what the future holds, but I know who holds the future. And that you and I, when the Bible says you preach the word and you be instant in season and out of season, yes, when things are pessimistic, when things look grim, when things look bad, I can simply say to all of us today that you and I need to hang tight on to the God of heaven and to His word, which gives us strength and encouragement. Not only the pessimistic season, but I call it the ecumenism season. Ecumenism. Preach the word, be instant in season, out of season. The season of ecumenism. We're living in that season. When everybody said, well, now, Brother Acuff, as long as we all just believe in God. Now, watch, isn't it interesting? It goes back to the book of Daniel, you remember? And he built this great image. What is that? Ecumenism. Everybody bow down. I've got this image. Look how wonderful it is. And I want everybody to bow down to it. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, no, we're not going to do that. We do not know what God will do. We're not. Oh, they could have. They could. You know how you used to. Tell something wasn't true, and you'd cross your fingers and put your hand behind your back and say something, and then all the I didn't mean it, because they could have said, well, fellas, tell you what, let's do. Let's put our hand behind our back, cross our fingers, and we'll bow down. And no, they didn't do that. They said, we're not going to bow down to your image. Everybody else may do it. But we're not going to bow down to that image. When you and I recognize that today, that is what the world is saying with denominationalism. Oh, everybody bow down to the image of denominationalism. You have your worship, we'll have our worship. You have your philosophy, we'll have our philosophy. And therefore, we want everybody just to fit. You know, they say, oh, do you believe in? Oh, I believe in God. In the book of Ephesians, chapter number 4. When I find individuals who want to have, who want to argue the concept, which is many, who want to argue the concept, all these denominations, they're good and they're wonderful and they're righteous. I ask them a question. Ephesians chapter number 4. The Bible says, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. There's one body. The Bible says not only is there one body, there's one faith, one baptism, one God and Father who is above all, through all, and in you all. I ask them a question. I want to ask you this question. How many gods are there? Well, Brother Acuff, there's one. Well, how many faiths? Oh, there's one. How many Lord? There's one. How many bodies? What was it yesterday? 33,000? That doesn't make sense. And so when you find this concept of ecumenism, that just as long as you have this feeling in your heart, I mean, a man may feel something. I remember several years ago that the young people would get, they'd get in, and they'd have these kind of youth groups, and they'd turn the lights down low, and they'll hold hands, and oh, I feel there's a feeling. Well, it wasn't. I'm gonna tell you, it wasn't a feeling that ought to have been there. And so this idea again of ecumenism this season, you and I must preach again today that there is one body and one spirit, even as you're calling, one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father is above all, through all, and in you all. And so when you and I look at the season, we see that season of pessimism. We see that season of ecumenism. And then there's another season, and that is the season of hedonism. The season of hedonism is simply that men are satisfied with pleasure. Whatever I can do to make me feel good. The Bible says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. When you and I go to Romans chapter 1, and the Bible tells us that the wrath of God cometh upon the children of disobedience. When you and I understand that, when we read Romans 1 verses 18 through verse 32, and we see the hedonism, the concept that men have rejected the God of heaven, that men have rejected the Bible, that men are looking at the satisfaction of pleasure. What makes me feel good? You know, the devil is the father of lies. John 8 verse 44. You can go back to Genesis chapter number 3. What God say? You don't need this tree. If the day thou eatest thereof, thou shalt not surely die. You have to watch. You have to watch the line. And our world, see, when you and I look at this, hedonism is nothing more than a lie. Because as Hebrews chapter 11, you and I read about, the Bible tells us Moses chose rather to suffer affliction with the children of God than to enjoy the pleasure of sin for a season. You know, it's kind of interesting how things sometimes pan out. I thought about this old boy. He got up. He was older gentleman. Don't fool with old people. Let me tell you, those of us, you get in trouble. And this old boy, he got up to get a drink of water, I guess. And when he went to the sink in his kitchen, he looked outside, and he had a shed out there. He saw two men, and they were taking things out of his shed. Man, he picked up the phone, called the sheriff's office, said, look, there are two men stealing stuff out of my shed. Dispatcher said, sir, are you in your house? He said, yes, ma'am, I am. She said, well, just stay in your house, lock your door, don't go out there. We do not have anyone that we can send right now. And as soon as we do, we'll send them out there, but we don't have anyone we can send right now. Well, he put the phone down, counted to 30, picked the phone up, called the sheriff's office back. Said, there's no need for you to come. I just went out there and shot them, and they're both dead. The dogs are pulling them out right now. Well, man, I'm telling you, in less than 5 minutes, six sheriff deputies, your helicopter, SWAT team, the sheriff, everything converged on his property. Well, they caught the guys. And the sheriff said, I thought you told me you shot them. He said, I thought you told me there wasn't anybody you could see it. Now, you know, things don't always appear the same. And see, when you and I look at the season of pessimism, or we see the season of ecumenism, or we see the season of hedonism. And so as a result of that, it has motivated individuals not to abide by the things that are written in the Word of God. Now, not only that from 2 Timothy 4, chapter, verses 1 through 4, 4, 1 through 4. Not only did he say, be answered in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, and exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. I want you to think of not only the word seasons, but I want you to think of the word saints. Because when you and I back up in the book of 2 Timothy chapter number 2 and verse number 2, the Apostle Paul said to this young man, Timothy, the things that thou hast learned of me among many witnesses, the same, what do you do with it? The same commit thou unto faithful brethren that they may be able to teach others also. The things that you have learned of me, what do you do with it? You take that message and you plant it into the hearts of men and women, boys and girls, and motivate them to do the will of God. I'm greatly concerned. Maybe some of you have read this book. As a matter of fact, I had not read it. Brother Keith, one of the lectureships at Memphis School of Preaching, Roy Johnson was speaking. And he referenced this book, Already Gone. Well, I immediately bought the book. I wanted to see what, I think a fellow by the name of Ken Ham, the guy who's done the Cincinnati, the Creation Museum in Cincinnati, and has recently had Noah's Ark, has written a book entitled Already Gone. And his premise is this. His premise is that our young men and women, our boys and girls, by the time they get to the seventh grade, he says, we've already lost them. Now, that may be true in denomination. I pray that it isn't true among our brothers and sisters in Christ. But you see, here's what has taken place. When you and I, when our boys and girls, when they get 30 minutes or 45 minutes on Sunday morning, and they get maybe 30 minutes on Wednesday night, and when you look that they are getting less than maybe 125 hours of Bible instruction during the course of a year, and then they're home watching television, some of them 6 hours a day, they're going to the school system, and they are saying to them, no, you've come from a lower form of animal. They hear every day on television and they see this, again, hedonistic concept, and they are pounded day in and day out. We must take our young men and women, boys and girls, and take the Word of God, not just plant it in their heart, but motivate them to obey it and do it. Do they know Genesis 1 through 11? The very basis, ladies and gentlemen, the Bible teaches us, thy word is true from the beginning. That do they understand and do they see? Because if you take Genesis 1 through 11 out of the Bible, the rest of it falls. Because there we have the introduction of sin. We have the introduction of man. We have the introduction of marriage. We see what happens when men think that they can override God. And so, we use that word saints. The things that thou hast learned of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou unto faithful brethren, that they may be able to teach others also. Let me give you a third word, and that's Satan. Now, again, look at what the Bible says. Preach the word. I charge thee, therefore, before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, Who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing in his kingdom? Preach the word, be instant, in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when men will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. You think Satan's just sitting back saying, well, I don't think I need to do anything. No, my friend, be sober, be vigilant. Your adversary, the devil, is a roaring lion, walking about seeking whom he may devour. The Apostle Paul wrote to the church at Corinth, and he said, lest Satan should get advantage of us, for we're not ignorant of his devices. And so when you and I read that they, after their own lust, in James chapter number 1, what happens? Men are drawn away of their own lust and enticed. And when that lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, brings forth death. That Satan is alive and well, and that Satan is doing everything within his power to defeat Christianity. You remember what Jesus said to Peter? Peter, Satan hath desired to have you that, listen to this, that he may sift you as wheat. That is what Satan desires of us. That if he can penetrate, wherefore seeing we also are compassed about by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. And so when you and I recognize again that Satan's desire is to take us and to... See, Satan wants your family. I'm going to talk about that a lot right now. I'll talk about it later this afternoon. But Satan wants, he wants to destroy you and your family. So when Paul said, I charge you before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, you preach the word and you be instant in season and out of season. Reprove and rebuke and exhort. Do it with patience. Why? The time will come. I thank God the time has not come to Sunday Slope. That you love God, that you love the Bible, that you love the truth. That's what this lectureship has been about, the truth of God. And so as a result of that, you have taken your heart and your mind and you've opened it up. And so therefore, you and I recognize that we need to love it and we need to preach it. Number two, that is, not only do we need to love it and preach it, but we need to activate it. When you and I, Hebrews chapter number 4, the word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. When you and I see the penetration of the Bible, the Bible has the effect upon us when we allow it to do so, that it makes our lives the kind of life that ought to be done. Four things I want you to remember in here. Number one, we need to pray about it. And we need to pray that the Word of God, when you and I read it and study it, that we activate it in our life. That our hearts will be open to Thee. That we will be receptive to the teaching of the will of God. That when you and I, when you take the Bible, and when you and I read it and we study it, Paul said in Ephesians 3, he said, you're going to understand the mystery when you read. You know, do you read? Now I'm going to just go to the second point I want to make and kind of combine. And that is, not only do we need to pray about it, but we need to ponder on it. In Psalm 1 verse 1, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, or sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law, listen to this, doth he meditate day and night. You know, we read the Bible sometimes like some people pray, "Dear Lord, bless me, my wife, my son John, his wife, us four no more." You know, we just take the Bible and it's kind of, I thought about the fellow who he's going to change. He said, I'm going to take the Bible and I'm going to do whatever the Bible tells me to do. I'm just going to let the Bible fall open and whatever it says, that's what I'm going to do. Well, he held his Bible like that and sure enough it fell open. And he said, whatever my eyes fall on the first page, I'm going to do it. And his eyes fell on this passage. And he went out and hanged himself. He thought, surely not. And so he said, I'm going to try it one more time. So he closed his Bible and let it fall open. And he said, now where my eyes fall? And if eyes fell on this, go and do thou likewise. Well, he said, I'm going to try it one more time. Surely not. And so he closed the Bible, let it fall open, and his eyes fell on this. Whatsoever thou doest, do quickly. Well, you know, that's the way some people read instead of the Bible. Do you ponder it? I think about this. You know, when the Bible says in Psalm 1, verse 1, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, or sitteth in the seat of the scornful. How many of our brothers and sisters in Christ have walked in the counsel of the ungodly? Here's a brother, he and his wife having marital problems. I mean, she just, man, you don't do what I tell you, you know, and she'd follow him out the door. I thought about the fella, the lady who used to give speeches. Somebody asked her, said, you know, what happened in your life? She said, a tramp changed my life. And I said, what do you mean? She said, well, I'll never forget this. And she said, one morning, I was at home and I was washing dishes. She said, I hadn't gotten dressed. I had my hair all rollers and I was washing dishes. And she said, a tramp knocked on my door. And she said, I went to the door and he said, ma'am, I'm sorry to beg. I'm sorry, but I'm hungry. I haven't had anything to eat. Can you? She said, get away from my door. You get away from my door. I don't help tramps. I don't help anybody. You just get away from my door. So she said, I went back and said, knocked on the door again. I went to the, he said, ma'am, I'm sorry, but he said, I have not eaten and I'm hungry and could you give me just some? She said, I said for you to get away from my door and don't you come back. And if you don't get away from my door, I'm going to call my husband. Well, she said, as he turned around and walked, he made a statement that changed my life. And as he walked away, he said, ma'am, your husband's not at home. And she thought, well, man, how do you know my husband's not at home? He said, ma'am, if your husband is home, he's sick because he wouldn't stay home with you unless he was sick. And she said, I began to think. Before he left, when he left for work that morning, I followed him out the car with a handful of bills. When are you going to pay these? What are you going to do? And she said, I changed my life. You see, folks, when we ponder, and I think of Psalm 1, and here some old boy gets into an argument with his wife. And they're feuding, fussing, and fighting. And he goes to the office and he goes to work. And boy, I'll tell you what, that woman, I'm gonna tell you, she's blah, blah, blah. And his old buddy's there at the factory or at the office where he said, man, I wouldn't put up with that. I'm telling you, if I wouldn't put up with my wife. I mean, I would tell her and I would leave or whatever. And you know who he's taking counsel from? Some old boy's been married 15 times, got 30 kids by 40 different women. The Bible says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Not only must we pray, we must ponder it, and then thirdly, we must practice it. That you and I take the word of God and it's planted in our hearts. And that's why David said, thy word is a lamp to my feet and a light unto my pathway. Because that you and I practice it on a daily basis. That when someone speaks evil of us, oh, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. In Ephesians 4 and verse number 32, the Bible said, and be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. That you and I recognize that the Bible, it comes alive in my life every day of the week when I take it and I activate it and I let the world see it, not because, everybody look at me now, no. I remember several years ago, one of our deacons at the Allen Park Church in Michigan, when I was preaching there, he came to me one Sunday night and he said, you know what my next door neighbor said to me? I said, well, he come out, he said, we're getting ready to come to a service tonight. My next door neighbor said, come out, and he said, "Where are you going, Donnie?" He said, "I'm going to church." He said, "Man, you must be awful sinful." And he said, "Why?" He said, "You go to church so much." See, this guy's concept was you only go when you go to see the priest or someone else and get your... No, see, folks, you and I practice it. Now, let me give you... Not only do we pray over it, ponder it, practice it, but we proclaim it. We proclaim it. No. Brother Keith, I thought about you and I. I just thought about how wonderful it would have been if you and I had stood up out there at the motel this morning breakfast and started preaching. They'd probably call the sheriff. You know what? There wasn't anybody else but Brother and Sister Mosier and Jack and I. You could tell everybody else, man, they're dressed, they're going to whatever it is they're going to do today. There's one thing that's not on our mind, and that is not... God is not on our mind, and the Lord's day is not on our mind, and worship is not on our mind. But we did not do that. Let me tell you how we do proclaim it. We proclaim it when our families... Can I preach to 12? Jet and I went to hear a lady. She is one of the most... I guess awarded. She's a comedian. I use this term religious in her concepts. We went to hear her not long ago. My daughter gave me some free tickets. Otherwise, I wouldn't have gone. But anyway, she made a statement that was in her dad. She said, "My daddy was a preacher." And she said, and he's deceased. And I thought, wow, oh man. She said, "Let me tell you something. What my dad was on Monday did not even match what he preached on Sunday." Man. See, my children, they saw me on Sunday in the pulpit. But if they saw a different person on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday, how do I proclaim it? By living it. Now, I've got one more point, and then we'll close. Number one, we've got to love it and preach it. Number two, we've got to activate it. Number three, we have to defend it. In the book of Matthew, chapter number 7, you remember that Jesus said, "Enter ye into the strait gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many there be that go in thereat. But straight is the gate, and narrow is the way that leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it." He said, "Beware of false prophets, which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they're ravening wolves. You shall know them by their fruits." And he asked a question, "Do men gather grapes of thorns and figs of thistles?" And he said, can a good tree bring forth evil fruit? And he said, "Can an evil tree bring forth good fruit?" A good tree can't bring forth evil, and an evil can't bring forth good. And he said, "Every tree that does not bring forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire." And then he goes into this. He says, "Not every man that saith to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he which doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven." He said, "Many will come to me in that day, and they say, Lord, did we not prophesy in thy name, and in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name do many wonderful works? And I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of iniquity." Oh, and the great lesson that we have of building our house upon the rock and not upon the sand. But when you and I look at Matthew chapter 7, and we look at verse 12 down through verse number 21, and you and I see that a decision has to be made. A decision has to be made. Are you and I going to... Notice what he said. "Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many there be go in there." Straight is the gate and narrow is the way that leads to life, and few there be that find. My friend, listen to this. You and I must make a decision. Are we going to stand firm on the Word of God, and are we going to practice it? Or are we just going to lollygag around in life with it? You and I, we're going to have... You know, somebody said, "Well, I lean toward the church." Well, hell's not built on a slant for those that lean. You and I must recognize that a man has to make it. Are you in or are you out? Are you going to follow God's word and do it or not? Time comes, make a decision. I remember many years ago, I was learning how to fly an airplane. And I don't know how many of you have ever learned, but one of the things they teach you to do in training pilots, you got to learn how to recover from a stall. And so what they would do, and there were a couple of different kinds of stalls, but what they'd do is we'd get in there. I was flying a Cessna 172, and so we'd get in and we'd go up about 5,000 feet. And we had the power, pull the power off of it, pull the stick back and get the nose. And when the nose, when it's straight up and when it starts shaking, that means you're about to stall. You better, you know, so at any rate, I don't know about you, but that scared the life out of me. Whew. I never did learn to enjoy that. And so at any rate, we got up there and so, man, what you're supposed to do, you're supposed to level your wings and your back. But let me tell you, when that plane started shaking, I took that stick and I just rammed it to the firewall. Well, when you do that, then you start going like this. And here we are now. We were going that way, now we're going this way. I'll never forget what that instructor said to me. He said, "You better do something." Now, brother and sister in Christ, or my friend out of Christ, you better do something. It's time to make a decision. Not only a decision, but what's the danger? Beware of false prophets. Brother Gary Collie yesterday, I loved his illustration of this. You remember that? How that the wolves circle around the sheep? See? Beware of false prophets. How do they come? Sheep's clothing. They just kind of wiggle their way in. Not only do you and I need to make a decision, not only should we be aware of the danger, but we also need to understand the deception. Satan is a deceiver. And because of his deception, there will be division. See, because what Satan wants to do is he wants to divide. I have said this many times, and I'm sure somebody could refute it maybe, but I've said this many times. If you take your preacher in a low congregation and your eldership and they stay together, someone's not going to be able to tear that congregation up. See, because what Satan wants to do, if he can take maybe one elder or he can take a preacher or he can take someone else and he can push that wedge in there, not only division, but then there is damnation as a result of that. Thy word is true. From the beginning. Thy word is true from the beginning, and every righteous judgment endureth forever. Everything here, ladies and gentlemen, will be there in the day of judgment. May God bless you.
Would open your books, number 248. 248. I know that my Redeemer lives and ever prays for me. I know eternal life He gives from sin and sorrow free. I know that my Redeemer lives. I know eternal life He gives. I know that my Redeemer lives. He wills that I should wholly be in word and thought. Indeed, then I His holy face may see when from this earth I flee. I know that my Redeemer lives. I know eternal life He gives. I know that my Redeemer lives. I know that over yonder stands a place prepared for me. A home I hast not made with hands, most wonderful to see. I know that my Redeemer lives. I know eternal life He gives.
Mark your books, number 311. It'll be the song after announces in prayer, number 311.
Good morning. It's good to see such a crowd here this morning at this hour during these lectures, the West Kentucky Bible lectures. So good to have everyone here. For those of you who are visiting with us, and we do have many in our audience this morning, we want you to know that we certainly do appreciate your presence, and we invite you to come and be with us again at any and every opportunity you have to come our way. In just a few moments, Brother Rick Nolte will word our first prayer, and at the close of service, Brother John Mays will dismiss us and also offer thanks for the meal. Those we have on the sick list this morning, Brother Fred Carter, remains in the Baptist Health Hospital. He has been moved into a room. He's in room 373. I understand that he is doing some better. Brother James McFall is also in the Baptist Health Hospital in room 490. Brother James has got pneumonia, but I also understand that he is doing quite better also. Racy McElrath, this is Sister Bernie Wall's daughter, one of her daughters, is in Lourdes Hospital in room 822. She's been in there a couple weeks, bad infection, and she's being treated there. Sister Louise Carmichael is also in the Lourdes Hospital in room 605. I'm not sure of her condition at this time. I know that she had broken her hip this past week. Let's also remember Brother Garland Elkins and Sister Corinne as they struggle with their problems even this day. That's all the sick that I know of. I'm sure there's probably others. If you'll let me know, of course, I'd be more than happy to announce them. Let's remember the area-wide gospel meeting that will start August 7th through the 9th. This year at the Carson Center, the Sunny Slope Congregation is hosting this effort. And the theme this year will be God Before Me. There are plenty of flyers if you haven't gotten them yet. There's plenty of flyers out here on the tables. Please take them, spread them out in the community, give them to your friends, invite others, that we will be able to make this a great success. Let's also remember that this afternoon, immediately after the service, we'll have a fellowship meal in the basement of the preacher's house. And also this hour, Brother Robert Taylor will be speaking to us concerning the whole armor of God. It's so good to have Brother Robert here with us. He agreed to pinch hit, if you will, for Brother Garland Elkins, who was supposed to be speaking at this time slot. It's good to have Brother Robert with us. He's always been good to come and help us out in any way that we've asked him. Are there other announcements? If not, we'll ask you to stand if you care to for the prayer and for the song that will follow.
Please pray with me. Our Father and our God in heaven, we are coming before you this day thankful for each breath that we take. We know it's a blessing from thee, knowing that you are our creator, that you have set all things in motion, and we are thankful. Especially, Father, we're thankful for your Son, Jesus, knowing that his sacrifice, the greatest suffering ever, a sin offering for the sins of mankind and for even for ours. Father, we thank you for him in all things. We again pray to you for those who were just mentioned, for their health, that their health will be returned to them. Be with us that we know that good days are followed by bad days, and that when these health problems come along, help us to look back to the good days rather than to suffer through and worry of what is yet to come. We pray to you for our country, for our leaders, for those who are protecting our country. We thank you for our liberties we have here. And we pray that you will be with all who have traveled so far to be here, that you'll watch over them as they make the returns home today, and bless them and watch over us all. Please forgive us of our sins. We pray thee in your Son Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen. 311.
Oh, what wondrous love I see, freely shown for you and me, by the one who did atone. Just to show his matchless grace, Jesus suffered for the race. In Gethsemane, oh,
This being the first day of the week when we come together to worship our God, we are commanded to partake of the Lord's Supper, this do in remembrance of me. The last week of Christ's life, we read about him going into Jerusalem and people praising him and doing many, saying many wonderful things about Christ being the prophet, the king, and so many things. But then within a week, they'd be hollering, crucify him, and within hours, he would be on the cross, dying, shedding his blood. But the institution of the Lord's Supper, we can read about that in Matthew chapter 26, verses 26 through 29. In reading it says, "And as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.' And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, 'Drink ye all of it. For this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.'" And then, some time later, on the day of Pentecost, when the church began, we read about the breaking of bread in Acts 2, verse 42. And then, many chapters later, in Acts chapter 20, verse 7, we read about the first day of the week, and they also breaking the bread. And then, we read about Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, starting at verse 23. "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me.' After the same manner also he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, 'This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye, as often as ye drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he comes.'" And that's why on the first day of the week, we as Christians partake of the Lord's Supper. Let us pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Father, we thank you for this beautiful day. We thank you that we can come worship you and do those things that you commanded, not only because you commanded, but because we love you so much. Father, we thank you for your Son. We thank you so much that he was willing to go to the cross and to die, which is what this memorial is for. To die on the cross for us and shed his blood because we have sinned, not him. Father, as we partake of this bread, we pray that we thank this life here on this earth, but more so his death. Father, we love you and we love your Son. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
thankful for this fruit of the vine, which the Christian represents the blood shed by Christ on the cross. We ask you that whoever partake of this will do so in a pleasing and worthy manner in thy sight. We ask all these things in Christ's name.
Separate and apart from the Lord's Supper, this is a time that we purpose to give back to our God. The authority that we have for this is found in first and other passages, found in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verses 1 and 2. Now concerning the collection for the saints, so I have given order to the churches of Galatia, even so do ye. Upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by him in store, as God hath prospered him, and that there be no gatherings when I come. Let us pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, Father, you're so holy, you're so wonderful, you're so marvelous. But Father, you're also so giving. We thank you for all the blessings that we have in this life, the physical blessings and the spiritual blessings. Father, we pray that we do those things that are necessary to take care of others and also to take care of the church, which your Son died on the cross and shed his blood and purchased it with his very own blood. Father, we love you and we pray that everything we have is yours. And we pray that we can please you today in giving back to you. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Let's stand and sing the song on the back cover of the book, Our God, He is Alive.
There is beyond the azure blue a God concealed from human sight. He tinted skies with heavenly hue and framed the worlds with His great might.
There is a God.
He is alive.
What a genuine it is on my part, Irene's part, to be with you once again. The very fact that we've been permitted to come year after year is something in which we take great delight. This has been a great lectureship from the very beginning, and this one is no exception. We have heard some exceedingly fine lessons. I told Brother Acuff after he had finished the one last hour that he preached more sermon material, more Bible in his lesson than some preachers will preach in a month or maybe even 6 months. I'm reminded of someone in Middle Tennessee that sent me a tape some years back. He was greatly concerned about what he had heard the Sunday morning before. He said, "Would you listen to it and make a comment?" I listened to it 2 or 3 times and I wrote him back and I said, he did not put enough scripture in his sermon or message that day to fill a small thimble. In fact, he talked about a New England poet, and I thought that if he wanted to talk about poetry, he should have gone to one of the poetic books of the Old Testament. His grandchildren were there. He spent about 10 or 15 minutes talking about them. Maybe he used 1 or 2 scriptures in 30 minutes of talking that day. And unfortunately, that has become the norm with many preachers, far too many, and many congregations that allow that to be true. So we need to preach the gospel. This has been a book and chapter lectureship from the very beginning. And that's in line with so many scriptures. So Isaiah suggested to the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them. Jesus one time said, "What is written in the scriptures, how readest thou?" And the Apostle Peter tells us in a very moving statement that we need to speak as the oracles of God, 1 Peter 4 and verse 11. Thank you for letting us come. Appreciate the hospitality of Sister Pat's home. We've been a guest in that home so many, many times, and she always treats us far better than we deserve. We appreciate that on her part. Had a marvelous meal with Michael and his family on Friday night. I told one of them that I thought we had the best fish that I'd ever eaten. A very fine meal indeed. Thanks for the good meal yesterday and the one that we'll have in a few moments of time. This morning, I'm going to try to take the place of one of the truly great preachers of all time, Garland Elkin. For 35 years, he has been a mainstay upon this lectureship. He had to miss one due to having an accident on the way here, and then this one. I know his heart is right here in Sunny Slope today. And he's been one of the best friends, one of the dearest friends I've ever known. I visited him in the hospital just a few days ago. Two of his daughters were with him, and one of them told me, they said, now, when Dad was being taken for one of his tests, he began to quote various passages of Scripture. And when he finished one, he said, that reminds me of another. When he finished that, he said, that reminds me of another. And so he certainly was and is one of the greatest preachers of our time. I think he has the finest recall of Scripture of any man that I have ever known. Now to the subject that was assigned to him and now assigned to me. It's taken from Ephesians, the 6th chapter, verses 10 through 18. We know it as the Christian's armor, or the whole armor of God. Just a little something about this epistle. It was written to a congregation located in Ephesus. Ephesus was a European city, or rather an Asiatic city, located in the western part of the country that we now know as modern-day Turkey, anciently referred to as Asia Minor. Paul visited the city of Ephesus in the closing part of his second missionary journey. He made a promise that if the Lord will, he would come later, which he fulfilled in the third missionary journey, staying there longer, according to the record, than any other place that he stayed in all of his marvelous work as an apostle, as a preacher of Jesus Christ. He must have planted so many wonderful seeds from the gospel among these people. It was one of the best educated congregations in all of the first century. It enjoyed the preaching of Paul. It enjoyed the preaching of Apollos. Aquila and Priscilla worked there. Timothy was stationed there for a period of time. Paul wrote them what we know as the Ephesian epistle, and a little bit later on, Christ will address a letter to them recorded in Revelation, the second chapter, verses 1 through 7. And so it was a highly instructed congregation in the Lord's work. We now look at the Christian's armor, and the Christian's armor is demanded of everyone. Paul has more to say about the church, I think, in the book of Ephesians than maybe any one other book. It's one of the four books in which he talks about the church as being the body of Christ. He does this in the Roman epistle, the 1 Corinthian epistle, here in Ephesians, and then in Colossians. I think that's the reason that I have suggested through the years that in a sense, this is Paul's masterpiece about the church. And I think it would be most incomplete if he had not stressed the Christian's whole armor. He briefly alluded to the armor that ought to adorn Christian in 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter. He wrote that book about 10 years before he penned the Ephesian epistle. But now he gives a very thorough discussion of the Christian's armor. Beginning in verse 10, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. He uses the term brethren in a very affectionate sense. He had obeyed the gospel. They had obeyed the gospel, no doubt many of them under the teaching of the Apostle Paul and those that came after him. And they were brethren. They were sons of God from the vertical standpoint. They were brethren in the Lord from the horizontal standpoint. And of course, they enjoyed the finest of Christian fellowship. James was very fond of the word brethren. If I've counted correctly, he uses it about 15 times in the five chapters that he wrote. Paul is very fond of the expression, brethren. No doubt both of them recall from time to time, the Holy Spirit calling it to their mind, that ye are brethren. We're not divided into a clerical system or a laity system, as the religious world talks about. Brother N.B. Hardiman used to say, now I can read about lying members in the church, I never read about lay members in the church. Well, we're all brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ. We've obeyed the gospel, that makes us children of God. That makes us a brother or sister to every other person that has heard, believed, and obeyed the gospel. When he said, finally, he's near the end of this great, marvelous, and magnificent epistle. Finally, my brethren, not somebody else's brethren, but his brethren. And then he says, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Notice that he's not talking about physical strength. He's not talking about the strength that might be in a person's hand or a person's arm or a person's back or a person's leg. He's talking about spiritual strength. Joshua was encouraged in the early part of his book to be strong. He was taking the place of Moses, and he needed the strength that only God can provide as he would lead these people across the swollen waters of the Jordan River and then in the conquering of Western Palestine, ultimately allotting each one of the tribes 9 1/2 west of the Jordan and 2 1/2 tribes that Moses had allotted to people who lived on the eastern side of the Jordan. But we are to be strong. And the Apostle Paul says, be strong in the Lord. Paul was fond of the expression in the Lord, in Christ Jesus, or in Jesus Christ. I've never counted the number of times that he used expressions like this in his writing, but I've told by those who have numbered it, that he uses these expressions 169 times in the 14 epistles that he wrote. Provided Hebrews is his, and I've long believed that it was. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. We serve a God who is all-powerful. We serve a Savior who is all-powerful. We serve the Holy Spirit who is all-powerful. They have their individual functions. Each one performs perfectly. But nevertheless, there is remarkable, unparalleled strength in God the Father, in God the Son, and in God the Holy Spirit. And then he said, put on the whole armor of God, that you might be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. The whole armor of God, not a portion of this armor, not most of this armor, but the entirety of this armor. And he's going to give a very brilliant and very beautiful description of what this armor, consists. But in order that we might escape the wiles of the devil, Jesus knew how to meet the devil. He knew how to defeat the devil. We read about the temptations that he endured at the very beginning of his ministry. Matthew has something to say about this in the opening part of Matthew 4. Luke does so, a little bit longer account than Matthew's account. He does it in Luke 4, and then Mark briefly alludes to it in Mark, the first chapter. The devil tried to get him to turn stones into bread. Instead of doing what Pat Boone later on would write, a miracle a day keeps the devil away, Jesus used the power of God's word. He recalled a scripture. Of course, he knew the Old Testament perfectly. He'd had a part in the giving of it. He recalled a passage in Deuteronomy 8:3, namely, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. The devil had said, if you be the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. The devil took him to a high pinnacle of the temple, probably overlooking the Kidron Valley below, which would be a deep drop indeed. And he said, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down. It is written, and he quoted a part of the scripture, not the entirety of it. And he said, Angels have been given instruction to bear thee up, lest any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. I remember the trip that I took to Bible Lands in 1970, and we were able to walk in the Kidron Valley the day that we were in the Jerusalem area, one of the days there. And I could not help but think that we are walking on the very place or the very area where Jesus would have landed had he cast himself off the pinnacle of the temple. And then I looked down, and there would scarcely have been a place that his feet could have landed that he would not have dashed a foot against a stone. But again, Jesus responded by quoting a scripture, namely, "Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God." The devil took him to an exceedingly high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their attendant glory, and said, "All these will I bequeath to thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me." And one of the writers suggested, "Such has been given unto me." It was a usurped thing on the part of Satan, but nevertheless, it must have been a strong temptation, or it would not have been a temptation. The Lord, by this time, is disgusted with the tempter, and he said, "Get thee hence, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve." He was not about to give any semblance of allegiance or do any kind of worship and service to the archenemy of mankind. He recalled scripture in order to meet the devil. He was strong in the strength that came from his Father and that came from the word that he and the Holy Spirit and the Father had already given the religious world. "Put on the whole armor of God that you might be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." He's talking about all the opposition, all of the enmity, all of the animosity that Satan and those under him would render to the church, would render toward the church, toward his people. And of course, the assaults that Satan has made, not only through human false teachers, these are not the only ones that we wrestle against, that's meant by flesh and blood, but also all the forces that have joined as allied helpers to the cause of Satan, namely the rulers of the darkness of this world and spiritual wickedness in high places. Jesus had to face not only false teachers among the Pharisees and among the Sadducees, among the Herodian people, but he also had to face Satan and all of the imps that served him. Jesus was able to defeat them because his was a complete trust in God. And so these are the forces against which we fight at a daily battle. And then, "Wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye might withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand." Notice the great emphasis placed throughout this armor about standing, and about taking, and about receiving, and about adding the various components of the armor to us as Christian people. Here we are to be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. We can make a quick journey through the Bible, whether we're talking about the great heroes of the Old Testament, patriarchal times or Mosaic time, or whether we're talking about the great and stalwart ones about whom we read in the New Testament. And we think about those who stood tall for the truth. Moses stood tall for the truth when Aaron and the people were interested in the worshiping and serving of an idol made under the direction of Aaron. And I've never been able to understand why Moses' older brother, Aaron by 3 years, allowed the Jewish people, or the Israelite people, they're not called Jews until sometime later, why he allowed them to pressure him into the making of a golden calf. They'd already been told, "Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any image that's from above, any image that's here upon the earth, or any that might be found anywhere." And yet Aaron gave in to this. But Moses is standing and standing tall. Not only that, Joshua standing tall for God and his cause. Near the end of his life in Joshua 24 and 15, he called upon the Israelite people whom he would soon leave and go into the next world. He said, you make a choice today whether you're going to serve the gods that were on the other side of the flood of the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you now dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I've often reflected upon this. Notice what Joshua did not say. He did not say, my family without me will serve the Lord. He did not say, I minus my family will serve the Lord. He did not say, neither I nor my family will serve the Lord. It's a family kind of thing. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. David stood tall for the truth. There are dips in his life, as we read in the book of 2 Samuel, the great blemish that fell upon him. But David, for the most part, stood tall for the truth. The prophets of the Old Testament, whether we're talking about Enoch, who walked with the Lord 300 or more years, whether we're talking about Noah, the great ark builder, whether we're talking about Abraham, the great father of the faithful, whether we're talking about Isaac or Jacob, whether we're talking about the prophets, Samuel, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, the 12 minor prophets, these men stood and stood tall. They were not going to compromise. They were not going to turn their back upon the Lord. They were going to tell the people exactly what God told them without any kind of addition, without any kind of subtraction, without any kind of difference made. This is what the Lord said. I like a statement that is made by Paul in 1 Corinthians 11 and then again in 1 Corinthians 15. He delivered what he received and he received what he delivered. In one of the cases, he's talking about the Lord's Supper, and Brother Glenn read passages along that line, or whether he's talking about the resurrection. Paul was interested in delivering what he received, and he received what he delivered. Wouldn't it have been fine, exceptionally fine, if every person that stood behind a pulpit, every person that's ever stood behind a Bible class lectern, had been content just to deliver what he receives from the Word of God, and what he receives from the Word of God is that which he delivered. The apostle stood tall. Paul stood tall. Stephen stood tall. Peter stood tall. And the others did the same. They were willing to give their life's blood in order to stay true to the God of heaven. Polycarp, about whom we read in early Christian history, one who had served the church in Smyrna as a bishop, as an elder for a long period of time, a personal friend of John the Apostle. When he was called upon to recant his religion, turn his back upon the Lord, and say, Caesar is Lord, they threatened him with death. He told them to bring on the fire and the wood, which they promptly did, aided by unbelieving Jews, and he died rather than recant the Lord. He said something like this in his dying moments. 86 years have I served him. Never has he done any wrong to me. How then can I turn upon my Lord and Savior? And he didn't turn. He was doing the very thing that Paul the Apostle encouraged the Ephesian people to do, and through his writings all of us to do, to stand tall and not give in, not compromise the truth at all. And then he talks about the breastplate of righteousness. He talks about the shield of faith. He talks about the sword of the Spirit. Whenever he talks about the breastplate of righteousness, righteousness, of course, is right doing. Preceding it would be right thinking, and right speech, and then right doing. The Bible tells us in Acts 10, Peter speaking to the household of Cornelius, he said, God is no respecter of person, but in every nation he that feareth him worketh righteousness and respects the God of heaven. The Apostle John said that righteousness is something that we do. He is righteous that does righteously. The Catholic world has developed a practice where they claim that some people have lived such upright and such noble lives that they really accumulated more good than they actually needed for their own souls, and the surplus has been placed into something like a bank of good works, and the person that comes up lacking can borrow from this. Our banks certainly don't operate on that theory. If my funds are depleted, they're not going to dip into yours and replace mine. Righteousness is something that we do. I believe this is something that would help us in Matthew, the 25th chapter, when Jesus told the parable of the wise and the foolish virgin. The wise virgins had taken sufficiency of oil. They were well prepared. The foolish ones had not. And when it came time to replenish their land, which were about to go out, the foolish called upon the wise to share with us, give us of your oil. And the wise one said, not so, lest there be not enough for us to share with you. They suggested you go out and pay for buy oil for yourself. I don't believe they're evidencing any kind of selfishness. They were calling upon the wise to give them something that the wise could not. Righteousness, preparation, and readiness when the Master came, when the Lord Jesus Christ came. And so the breastplate of righteousness is right doing. And then have your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Remember what Isaiah said about how beautiful are the feet of them that bring good news and glad tidings, something about the messengers of the cross, that even their feet are spoken of as being beautiful. Having your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. God is spoken of as being the God of peace. Jesus is spoken of in Isaiah 9:6 as being the Prince of Peace. And the gospel is spoken of as being the gospel of peace. Jesus, in a bright and beautiful beatitude, said, blessed are the peacemakers, not the peace breakers. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. And so they were to have their feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. And then they were to have the shield of faith. They were to have faith in God. They were to have faith in Christ. They were to have faith in the Holy Spirit. They were to have faith in the power and efficacy of God's word. The shield of faith. It would shield them from the darts of the tempting one, namely from Satan. And then he spoke about the helmet of salvation. Salvation, of course, is the same as pardon. It is the same as forgiveness. We reach and attain salvation by obeying the gospel. That's why the Bible emphasizes so much that we need to hear the word of the Lord, Romans 10:17. We need to believe from the depths of our heart and soul that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. We need to repent of our sin, as Jesus taught in Luke 13:3 and 5, and as Paul emphasized in Athens, Acts 17 and verse 29. And then we are to confess our faith and be baptized for the remission of our sin. This is the helmet of salvation. The Roman soldier depended upon the helmet in order to protect his head, just as he depended upon the breastplate in order to protect his lung and his heart, just as he depended upon the belt that went around his armor in order to keep everything intact, just as he depended upon the feet being in preparation, maybe wearing something on his sandals like hobnail, in order that he might have firm footing when he fought on a one-to-one basis, as many of the skirmishes of the past demanded. And then he mentions the sword of the Spirit. This is the word of God. This is our weapon that we use from an offensive standpoint. Well, the Coleman Allman and I were classmates at Fried Hardeman College. We began to preach about the same time. He told me one day after he had returned from a preaching trip, and in those days, not many of us had cars. We had to depend on borrowing somebody's car or maybe traveling by bus, which he and I often did. But as he was traveling to his Sunday appointment on a Saturday afternoon, he had to wait in the bus station for a little while, and there were a couple of young ladies sitting pretty close by, and he said to himself and out loud, I think I'm going to open my suitcase and take out my sword. He said those young ladies had every attentive eye upon him. Of course, when he opened his suitcase, he took out the Bible. That, of course, was the sword of the Spirit. The sword of the Spirit is the Word of God Almighty. It is the all-powerful Word. The Bible tells us in Romans 1:16-17, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. Righteousness there comes from a Greek term from which we obtain such modern explosive term as dynamite and dynamo and dynamic. One of the writers of the past, a man by the name of Robertson, he has a fine series of studies of the Greek language. I've often appealed to what Robertson had to say, even though he was of the Baptist persuasion. Many times he would resort to Baptist preaching and teaching, but nevertheless, he was a great scholar of the Bible. He enjoyed talking about the Bible or the gospel as God's dynamite, capable of blessing sin out of the hearts of men and women and boys and girls, providing the dynamic energy that we need in order to be the people of God. God's Word is powerful. The Word of God is quick and powerful, we're told in Hebrews 4:12. And then it's described. The Word of God is going to endure forever. Isaiah assures us of that in Isaiah 40 and verse 8. The Word of our God shall stand forever. Jesus said in Matthew 24:35, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. Peter, in talking about the new birth, in the latter part of 1 Peter, the first chapter, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God which liveth and abideth forever. And then he repeats it again in verse 25. The word of our God is not going to be destroyed. There was a man who served as a king, one of the worst men that ever lived, Jehoiakim, had one of the best fathers that ever lived. He turned out to be one of the worst sons that any man ever had. Jehoiakim hated the word of God. He hated in particular the prophecies of Jeremiah. And when they were read to him, he took his infamous penknife, cut the scriptures to pieces. Not content with just that, he took the cut pieces and cast them into the fire burning on the hearth before him. But Jehoiakim did not destroy the word of God. He did not destroy what Jeremiah had just written. In fact, the Lord said, Jeremiah, write it again, and this time we'll add to it, which he promptly did. There was a man among the Roman emperors, a man by the name of Diocletian. He ruled over the Roman Empire in the latter part of the 200s, the early part of the 300s. He hated and despised the word of God. He made it one of his great goals to destroy every copy of the Bible in all of the empire. I suppose that he died thinking that he had succeeded. But Constantine, who succeeded him, called for the scriptures, and there were many copies that had been preserved by people who loved God's word far more than they did the Roman emperor who hated Christ and Christianity. There was a man in France, a man by the name of Voltaire, who lived way back in the 1700s. He thought the word of God would soon die, would no longer be here, would no longer influence mankind. And then we had a man in our country, Robert G. Ingersoll, Robert Glenn Ingersoll. He went all over this country lecturing on the mistakes that Moses made. I think it would have been interesting if Moses could have come back and talked about some of the mistakes that Ingersoll made, because he made far more than he ought to have made. But he thought that within 15 years, he died in 1899, this would have been in 1914, he said the Bible will be dead. The Bible will no longer influence mankind. 1914 came and passed, and Ingersoll was still in the morgue, or still in the grave, or sepulcher, wherever they buried him. But the word of God, which he hated, continued to march on and on and on. The communistic world have tried to destroy it. The Islamic world would like to destroy it and place the Mormon, or place the Islamic book, the Quran, on the throne of everybody's heart. Well, they're not going to destroy the word of God, not Jehovah's word, and yet they are a threat to the entire world, as we have witnessed since the early part of this century. But God's word is powerful, and it's going to accomplish that. Isaiah assures us in his book that the word which I send is not going to return unto me void. It will accomplish where I, the purpose whereunto I have sent it. And then last of all, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Not just a few, but all of the saints, all of the saints that lived in the first century. And of course, the writers in the New Testament, Paul included, would have suggested we need to pray for all men. Paul prayed for his unbelieving kinsmen. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness, going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves to the righteousness of God. We cannot pray for people to be saved in their unbelief and their disobedience and their defiance of the Word of God, but we can pray that their hearts might be softened, that they might be sensitive, that they might be touched by the truth and ultimately come to the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. And so praying is certainly important. Paul suggested in the first epistle, pray without ceasing. First epistle that he wrote, 1 Thessalonians 5:17. Continue in prayer, he told the Colossian brethren. Be instant in prayer. He says in what I consider the golden chapter of the book of Romans, chapter 12. Prayer. We ought to pray consistently. We ought to pray fervently. We ought to pray on a regular basis. Jesus tells us in Luke 18:1 that men ought always to pray and not to faint. Look at the marvelous example that we have of our Lord. At times he would arise early and go into a place of prayer. After a busy day of preaching and teaching and healing and helping people, sometimes he would depart into a mountain where he would pray. In fact, he prayed all night, according to Luke, the 6th chapter, before he selected from among his disciples the 12 apostles. He believed in prayer. We have the longest recorded prayer in John, the 17th chapter. He knew the power of prayer. He had been with the Father, or with the first person throughout eternity, and would ever be with the Father in eternity, as all of us can be with him in eternity if we're faithful and fervent to the very end of life. But prayer is certainly powerful, and we ought to be a prayerful people. We ought to pray daily, far more than just one time a day. Many times a day we can pray. It doesn't have to be an extended prayer in order to be heard, but it will be heard if we pray in harmony with his will. Brother Gus Nichols used to tell about a man with whom he conversed. He said, this man said to him, "Brother Nichols, I never pray because I do not believe that the Father would hear my prayer." I don't know exactly how I would have handled that, but I admire the way that Brother Nichols did. He said, "Sir, I want you to go out at midnight tonight, if it's a clear night, and I want you to look up at heaven, and I want you to clench your fist, and as you look toward heaven, I want you to use every cursing term you've ever heard in your life and direct it to God." The man was absolutely shocked. He said, Brother Nichols, I would not dare do that." Brother Nichols said, "Why?" He said, "Well, the Lord would hear all of that cursing." Brother Nichols said, "You mean to tell me that he'll hear you when you curse and will not hear when you pray to him in harmony with his will?" That ought to have made a profound impression upon that person's heart. I guess it never occurred to him that there would not have been a way for him to have been forgiven of his sin. Because when we sin, we have to pray for the forgiveness of that sin as an erring child of God. A beautiful, magnificent, and monumental passage in the verses that we've covered, Ephesians 6, verse 18, the Christian's armor. Not the partial armor, not most of the armor, but the entirety of that armor. If you're here today and have never obeyed the gospel, we want to encourage you to do that very thing. Hearing the truth, believing what it says about Jesus, repenting of your sins, making the good confession, in the words of a great hymn, sweetest name on mortal tongue, and then upon that confession, be immersed in water for the remission of sin. God has a second law of pardon, namely repentance and confession and prayer. Peter told the erring Simon to repent and pray. And John and James will tell us that we need to confess our sin and to admonish those sin and pray for the forgiveness of the same. If you're here today, never obeyed the gospel, we hope that you will come as together we stand and sing.
God is coming, the prodigal coming without delay. Here, oh, here, he calling now for thee. Love of you, wonders so far from his presence come today. Here is loving voice calling still. Calling now for thee.
Cherish it, hold it dear to our hearts, and be willing to protect it as those who have gone on before us have done, that we can have thy holy word this morning. Heavenly Father, we are thankful for all of those who have spread the gospel through the years, and those of us who have lived and tried to get others to be obedient to thy word. Continue to bless us. Continue to bless this congregation, that we can spread forth thy word to a greater degree as days come and go. We are thankful to thee for those who have prepared the good meals for us, for the one that we're about to partake of. We're so thankful for that. May this food nourish us and strengthen us. And we ever give thanksgiving for the physical blessings that thou art providing for us day by day. And may it give us energy and strength that we will use it in thy service and to the glory of thee and thy Son, and for the benefit of helping others know the truth. Walk with us day by day. Ever love us. Bless the elders of congregations, this congregation, and other congregations all over the world. We might ever hold firm to these old paths. Continue to keep us. Bless us until the end. And when it comes time for us to depart this life, we'll be prepared for that eternal home. We ask it all in the name of Jesus,